Hello everyone, hope all of you are doing well. Welcome back to your biology class. So students, I want to ask you one question. What is a human impact means on their environment? Yes, something that make the world better. But this human impact is of two types. There are negative impacts that are hurting the world, and we discussed about pollution in our last lecture that actually alter the environment. But there are positive impacts of human also there on their environment, that impacts are actually helping the world. And today our topic is actually based on humans' positive impacts on their environment. So let's get started. Topic number 4 of this chapter, conservation. So what is conservation means? The process of looking after the natural environment is called conservation. So specifically in biology, what is conservation means? Maybe this term you studied in different subject in your previous class, but according to biology, conservation is actually the management of nature and earth's biodiversity with the aim of protecting species, their habitats and ecosystems from excessive rates of extinction and the erosion of biotic interactions. So students, you know, conservation attempts to maintain or increase the range of different species living in an area, that is called biodiversity. But we have seen that one of the greatest threats to biodiversity is the loss of habitats. And each species of living organism is adapted to live in a particular habitat. If this habitat is destroyed, then the species may have no place to live and they become extinct. So in the conservation program, we are actually going to increase the biodiversity and saving their habitats. So there is an interaction between living organism with their environment. So we are saving the ecosystem from excessive rates of extinction. So if we are not destroying their habitats, so species will not get extinct. Like for example, students in tropical rainforest have a very high biodiversity compared with almost anywhere else in the world. But this is one of the main reasons that why people think that conserving them is so important, because now this tropical rainforest is in serious threat. So when tropical rainforests are cut down or burned, the habitats of thousands of different species are destroyed. So if their habitats are destroyed, then the species become extinct. On the other hand, we have already seen how and why deforestation occurred. And another kind of habitat that is under threat is wetlands. Like people drain wetlands so that it can be more easily farmed. We build roads and houses, destroying whatever used to grow on that land. We farm animals in large numbers on land that can not easily produce enough vegetation to support them, so that the land become a semi-desert. It causes desertification. So what is the importance of conservation? The most obvious reasons for conservation are to protect wildlife and promote biodiversity. Try to preserve wetlands so that it can be easily farmed, and restoring degraded habitats. The students, many governments are attempting to make sure that especially important habitats are not damaged, and most countries have a special area where people's activity are carefully controlled, ensuring that wildlife can continue to live there. And also the loss of money from agriculture in this area can be regained by allowing tourists
to visit them. And the most successful project actively involve local people who are usually delighted to see their environment being cared for so long as they can still make a living from it. Students, you know, people always need to use resources that we take from our environment. These include food, fuel, such as fossil fuel, and minerals such as ores of copper or aluminium. If we are careful, then we can take and use these resources without doing too much harm to their organism. So we say that resources is sustainable. What does it mean? A sustainable resource is a resource that can be continuously replenished, or there is an endless amount of it that can be captured. If we can, like for example, if we can keep on using it so it does not run out. So a resource is sustainable if we can keep on using it but it does not run out. A sustainable resource can be used again and again, so is more sustainable. Example, water, fish and wood. Like for example, fish in the sea could be a sustainable resource. As long as we do not take so many that their population fall to dangerously low levels. On the other hand, wood for fuel could be sustainable resource. So long as we replant trees to replace the ones that we cut down, or make sure that plenty of young trees are allowed to grow naturally. But unfortunately, many of the resources that we take from the earth are not sustainable. So a non-sustainable resource will eventually run out, so it is not sustainable in the long run. Like for example, fossil fuels such as gas, oil and coal. Because fossil fuels are a good example of non-sustainable resource. These fuels were formed millions of years ago from dead plants and bacteria, as you study in your previous class. But there are partially decayed bodies were compressed and formed coal, oil and gas. This took a very long time to happen. These fossil fuels cannot be replaced. So once we have used them, they are gone forever. So we therefore need to limit our use of fossil fuel to ensure that there will be still some available for future generations. So recycling non-sustainable resources reduces waste. So one way that we can help to conserve non-sustainable resources is to recycle things that are made from them, like used cans, bottles, paper and cardboard can be recycled, which reduces the need to use extra resources.
So students, you know, one way that we can help to conserve non-sustainable resources is to recycle things that are made from these materials. So for that matter, we are going to discuss about the first is recycling glass. Students, you know, the glass is made from natural and abundant raw materials like sand, silicon oxide, soda ash, sodium carbonate and limestone calcium oxide that are melted at very high temperature to form a new material, glass. Students, you know, these all like sand, soda ash and limestone, these all materials are non-sustainable resources, and the best glass is made from especially pure sand, which is get from mined from deposit which made long ago. So making new glass is actually making heating these chemicals to a very high temperature. So it's mean if we give them a very high temperature, so it release a lot of carbon dioxide, and a lot of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, so it can trap more heat and it can lead to global warming. So used glass can be crushed and melted at high temperature and then used to make new glass objects. This method or this recycling glass method is actually releases much less carbon dioxide than making new glass. And on the other hand, it also reduces our use of the raw materials like sand, soda ash and limestone. So the second recycling is recycling plastic. Students, you know, plastic is made from fossil fuel, and we discussed about in topic pollution that plastics are non-degradable, so they are the major cause of environmental pollution because they are not decomposed by decomposers. So plastic recycling is the process of recovering scrap or waste plastic and reprocessing the material into useful products. Plastic actually contain organic materials that contain elements such as carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, chlorine and sulfur. So what are the raw materials? Plastics are actually made from oil, natural gas and coal. As I mentioned before that they are made from fossil fuel, and fossil fuel is actually non-sustainable resource. So it means plastics are derived from natural organic materials such as cellulose, coal, natural gas, salt and of course crude oil. Students, if we can reuse plastic objects such as bottle over and over again, so that will reduce the amount of fossil fuels. So we have to use to make them. So if we cannot reuse things, then we can still recycle them. So now let's discuss about the recycling method. The simplest of plastic recycling processes involve, first step is collection. Collecting the plastic materials, that is recycle. Secondly, sorting. Plastics are usually sorted in few ways, such as the type of plastic, that material it is made with, color of plastic, or how it was made. Third step is washing. The goal of this step is to remove impurities and everything that is not made from plastic. Like for example, if in the plastic some leftover food, fruits, vegetable, anything is there. So we wash in this step. Fourth step is shredding. Shredding or granulating. The plastic waste is converted into small particles. So this step is actually, and this shredding method increases the surface area of the plastic and making it easier to process, reshape and transport if needed. Next step is melting. The small particles are smashed and melted together into plastic pellets. The last step is pelleticizing, and this is the most interesting steps because the pellets can be used in the production of other plastic products. Like this final step is actually decide what shape the plastic is going to be made. So now we are going to discuss about the recycling paper. Students, you know, paper is actually made of cellulose fibers from plants, usually trees. So the process of waste paper recycling most often involves mixing of old paper with water and chemicals to break it down to form a pulp. And then it passes through filters that removes glue, like for example to hold together the pages of magazines, and then it treated to remove the printing ink from it. After that, it is then chopped up and heated, which breaks it down further into strands of cellulose fiber. So this leaves clean cellulose fiber, which can be made into new newspaper. As students, you know, recycling paper does reduce the number of trees that have to be cut down to make new paper. But in fact, most paper mills use trees that are specially grown for the purpose, and each time some are cut down, new ones are planted to replace them. But the main advantage of recycling paper is that it causes less water and land pollution than making new paper, and it also uses less energy. So recycling paper actually conserves natural resources. It saves energy, reduces greenhouse gas emission, and keeps landfill space free from other types of trash that can be recycled. On the other hand, it also saves waste paper from occupying homes of people and producing methane as it breaks down. Yes. Because paper fiber contains carbon originally, which is absorbed by tree from which it was produced. And then this recycling actually keeps the carbon locked up for longer and out of the atmosphere. And it is also important to take into account that energy, which is usually come from fossil fuel, and it is used in collecting and transporting the used paper, which can be quite significant in the process of recycling paper. So we have to also think about it. But our focus is to save the fossil fuel and avoid atmospheric pollution. So now we are going to discuss about recycling metals. Students, we get metals from ores that are found underground. Mining metals ore uses a lot of energy, usually coming from fossil fuel, and on the other hand it also damages habitats, because metal ores are also non-renewable resource or non-sustainable resource. But the good thing about metal recycling is that metal can be recycled over and over again without altering its properties. So the most common recyclable metals include aluminium and steel, and other metals, for example, silver, copper, brass and gold, they are so valuable that they are rarely thrown away to be collected for recycling. But still, in some parts of the world, aluminium, copper, lead, steel and zinc are recycled. Like for example, recycling aluminium saves 95% of the energy that would be used in mining aluminium ore and extracting aluminium metal from it. Students, you know, aluminium is actually a silvery white lightweight metal, and it is soft and malleable. Aluminium is used in huge variety of products, like for example, cans, foils, kitchen utensils, window frames and aeroplane parts. This is because of its particular property. And on the other hand, you know, the aluminium, it's so useful that this metal actually prevents oxygen, moisture and bacteria from damaging the food. So that's why, you know, we are here, we are frequently using aluminium foil boxes and aluminium foil wrappings. And even in pharmaceuticals, you know, they use aluminium in their packaging as well. This is because it can store goods without needing refrigeration. So you can say, the way we look at it, aluminium is the superhero of all metals. So what is the benefit of recycling of metals? It save, you know, more economic, like less energy is needed to produce metal. Otherwise, the fossil fuel, which is a non-sustainable resource, it runs out. And secondly, it causes less damage to the environment. Like if we are mining somewhere, so it can, causes habitat destruction. And fewer quarries and mines, and less noise and less heavy traffic. And it saves valuable raw materials. Like it reserves of metals ores will last longer. So students, let's discuss about sewage treatment. As students, you know, sewage treatment is used for water recycling. As students, water is actually a scarce resource in many parts of the world. What is the meaning of scarce? Scarce means water is found in restricted quantity or it is not in that much amount around. So water that we have used can be recycled. So sewage treatment is a process that removes the majority of the contaminants and impurities from the wastewater or sewage and produces both a liquid and effluent. Effluent means after the sewage treatment, the clear water is released to the suitable for disposal into the natural environment like rivers, ponds and seas, and sludge. Sludge is actually a form of semi-solid form, which is actually formed as a result of industrial process, and this sludge is actually spreaded onto the landfill site and it dried and then applied to the agriculture site and used as a fertilizer. A student, sewage should not be allowed to run into the rivers or the sea before it has been treated, because this is because it can harm the people and environment. An untreated sewage is called raw sewage. Raw sewage is mainly water containing excrement. Excrement means excreta of mostly humans, urine, feces, toilet papers, detergent, which is coming from houses and our kitchens, oils, industrial release and debris such as sanitary towels and plastic. So it is therefore important that sewage is treated to remove any pathogenic microorganism and most of the nutrient before it is released as effluent. And you know, the excrement is the major source of harmful microorganisms including bacteria, viruses and parasites. So when sewage has been treated, the water in it can be used again. So sewage treatment enables water to be recycled. If we did not recycle water in this way, then significant amount of water shortage would occur in many parts of the world. So sewage is treated to make it safe. So students, let's discuss about how wastewater or sewage water is treated. So in the primary treatment or the first step, the raw sewage is passed through the screens. These trap large objects such as grit, which may have been washed off roads and they are large gravels. The screen liquid is then left for a while in settlement tanks, where any insoluble particle drift to the bottom and form a sediment. In the next step, there are two different ways in which the resulting liquid can now be treated. The first method is trickling filter, and the second method is activated sludge. So let's discuss them one by one. So the first method, trickling filter, actually what happened in the liquid from the settlement tanks is sprinkled over our trickling filter beds. This is made of a small stones and clinkers, this part. Many different aerobic microorganisms actually lives on the surface of the stones. So some of them are aerobic bacteria, so which feed on various nutrients in the sewage. Protoctase, what like single celled animal organisms, for example amoeba, they feed on the bacteria. Fungi also feed on soluble nutrients. So you can say in the trickling filter, these microorganisms actually make up a complex ecosystem, and after that this liquid is trickled onto the surface of the stone through the holes in a rotating pipe. See, these pipes are rotating like this, and this makes sure that air get mixed in the liquid, because they are aerobic bacteria, so they need air aeration. The liquid trickles quite slowly through the stones and giving the microorganism plenty of time to work on it, and by the time the water drain out of the bottom of the bed, so it's look clear, smells free, clean and contains no pathogenic organism and can safely allow to run into the river or on the sea. The second method is activated sludge method. In this method, the liquid from the settlement tank, okay, runs into a tank called an aeration tank. Okay, and after that, what happened? Trickling filter, just like a trickling filter bed, these contain aerobic microorganisms, mostly bacteria and protists. So oxygen is providing by bubbling air through the tank, and as the trickling filter bed work, these aerobic microorganisms make the sewage harmless. But the question is that why this method is called activated sludge? Activated means that microorganisms are present. So some of the liquid from the tank containing these microorganisms is kept added to the next lot of sewage coming in. So, and what is the meaning of sludge? As I also mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, that sludge means that just what is semi-solid materials in sewage. And after the aeration tank, it can turn into a chlorophyll settlers. So microorganism sinks there, the sludge at the bottom is called activated sludge, and it's returned to the aeration tank again. So a student that discussed about again activated sludge treatment of sewage. Okay, so the first step is homes, industries and offices, the sewage is coming, and then it can enter into in grit tank. The grit tank is actually remove stones and grit. And then next is sedimentation tank. Sedimentation tank or primary settlement tank, here the solid waste sink and are sent to the anaerobic digester. Anaerobic digester means here there is no aeration and anaerobic microorganisms are there. Next is aeration tank. Aerobic microorganisms grow and feed on the organic matter. And after that, it can release into the secondary clarifier. Secondary clarifier, also called secondary settlement tank. Here, microorganism actually sink. The sludge at the bottom is called activated sludge. Why? Because it contains microorganism and is returned to the aeration tank. Okay. And after that, next step here, the disinfection happens. And then the effluent water. This effluent is actually liquid, is now clear and does not smell and has no pathogenic organism, as I mentioned before, and it can be safely released into rivers and seas. Here then, from this aeration tank, the sludge is released. Here microorganisms are there, so they can digest the organic matter. And in the settlement tank, okay, here also anaerobic digestion happen, and it actually contains no air, and so it means that aerobic bacteria killed. And after that, what happened? Anaerobic bacteria feed on the organic matter and they release methane. So this methane, it can be used as a fuel. The remaining sludge can be used as a fertilizer. So this is the whole process of sewage treatment. So students, you know, both the trickling filter method and the activated sludge method can run into problems if the sewage contain substances which harm the microorganism. Like for example, it includes heavy metal like mercury, disinfectants or large quantities of detergent. So heavy metals and disinfectants are toxic to many of the microorganisms, and detergent also cause foaming. So which stop oxygen getting into the liquid. So to solve this problem, the contaminated sewage can be diluted before being allowed to enter the trickling filter bed or the activated sludge tank. And on the other hand, so far we have described that the liquid part of the sewage is treated. So what about the solid part? Solid part is semi-solid part we discussed is sludge. So this activated sludge method also produce sludge. So it means this material contain lot of living or dead microorganisms, like aerobic dead microorganism and anaerobic living organism. So it contain valuable organic material. So it is it's not a pity to waste it. So the sludge can be acted on by anaerobic bacteria. So the sludge is put into large closed tank. Inside the tank, several different kinds of bacteria act on the sludge, and some of them produce methane, as I mentioned before, so which can be used as a fuel. So when they have finished, the remaining solid material have to be removed from the tank, and it is now used as fertilizer, and it is usually quite safe because it is a very unlikely contain any pathogenic organism. So at the end of the lecture, you are able to understand about conservation, what is conservation means, the process of looking after the natural environment, and we discussed about the sustainable resources that we can use again and again and it can not run out. And we also discussed about the need to conserve non-sustainable resources. And we also discussed about that how recycling can help to conserve the resources like our fossil fuel and important metals. So this is all about conservation topic. I hope you understand it well. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye bye.